this proclamation on behalf of the city on Autism Awareness Month, which is April 2009. Whereas autism is a lifelong neurological disability characterized by impaired social interaction and communication, and whereas groups such as Autism Society of America, Santa Barbara, are committed to their mission of advocacy, support, education, and providing awareness to families, professionals, and community members toward a better understanding of this disability, and whereas autism now occurs in one out of 150 children, and whereas autism is the fastest growing developmental disability in the United States, affecting 36,900 individuals in California, whereas on average this year, 14 children per day enter our state's developmental services system with full syndrome autism, and whereas early diagnosis and appropriate treatment helps individuals with autism and related disorders reach their highest potential, and whereas autism is a complex disability that requires research to one day find a cure, prevention, and appropriate interventions, and greater recognition and understanding to ensure those individuals with autism living in the city of Santa Barbara and all other individuals with autism are accurately diagnosed and appropriately treated throughout their lifetime. Now, therefore, I, Dale Francisco, on behalf of Mayor Marty Bloom, by virtue of the authority vested in me as Mayor Pro Tem of the City of Santa Barbara, California, do hereby proclaim April 2009 as Autism Awareness Month and encourage members of our community to develop a greater understanding of this complex disability that affects so many individuals in the city.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, members of the council. Thank you so very much for honoring us with this proclamation. I'm Marcia Eichelberger. I'm the president of the local chapter of the Autism Society of America, Santa Barbara, and I'm with Sandy Shove today, who is our vice president. Access to healthcare, educational opportunities, and social inclusion required to live a full and meaningful life is a fundamental right of all human beings. This right has been recognized and upheld in every legal culture of the world. But with autism spectrum disorders, pervasive discrimination exists on a global scale. Proper and timely access to medical diagnosis and treatment are typically not available. Regardless of ethnicity, economic status, nationality, religion, or country, individuals with autism and their loved ones are systematically discriminated against and left to fend for themselves to locate the most meager of supports and interventions. We at ASA call upon our local community to adopt the following principles and to encourage the attitudes and undertake the concrete actions necessary to make them a reality. People with autism have the fundamental right to live an independent and meaningful life, have direct involvement in decisions affecting their lives, receive accessible and appropriate education, housing, assistance, care, and support services, as well as sufficient income, and freedom from threats, discrimination, social exclusion, and cruel and abusive treatment. Indeed, this requires a new way of thinking. Assuring rights for those with autism is the new human rights frontier of our time. Our society's reaction to the predicament of those directly affected by autism needs to rise to a greater scale of moral maturity. I'd like to ask Sandy to just give you a few little tidbits about ASA.
The Autism Society of America's National Office established April as National Autism Awareness Month in 1972. This observance provides an opportunity for the ASA, its state chapters, and others in the autism community to educate the public about this disorder. The high rate of autism among all races, ethnicities, and social groups points to a greater need for education, particularly with regard to the early diagnosis of this complex developmental disorder. Autism Society of America Santa Barbara chapter provides local support to families affected by autism and related disabilities throughout the county. We are the primary resource for individuals and families living with autism. Through our four pillars of advocacy, awareness, education, and support, we dedicate ourselves to empowering people to succeed in living with autism. And in honor of Autism Awareness Month, I invite you to go to the Downtown Public Library, main level. We have our annual Autism Awareness Month display set up right along the main corridor, right just past the circulation desk. We have literature about our organization, about the disorder, and the library staff has been kind enough to pull a number of resources from their own collection and make those available on the display as well. We invite you to avail yourselves of that and encourage others to do so. We also want to let you know that throughout the county, we've been celebrating. The Saturday the 4th, we had our second annual awareness and resource fair in Santa Maria, attended by our guests is about 400 individuals. We had 21 informational speakers and 28 vendor booths providing resources to the North County community. At the end of this month, we are hosting again, in collaboration with the Cambridge Center for Behavioral Studies, the annual autism workshop, or I guess it's the Cambridge Center Conference on Autism, brings in behavioral research scientists from across the country to share research and practice with teachers, parents, professionals, agencies, public and private. That will be Friday the 24th of April at the Marriott Santa Ynez Valley in Buellton. So we encourage you to let your constituents know about that as well, especially if people are looking for good research evidence-based practices. There's just too much to do, not enough time, and certainly not enough dollars. And we encourage those who make decisions on behalf of people with autism to use those evidence-based practices first so that they know those dollars are being spent in the most effective way possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And Sandy, I just want to tell you that praying for your father, and I'm even more impressed with your activism on days like today. Thank you.
Item 2, proclamation declaring April 2009 as Children and Nature Awareness Month.
And we have some representatives of Parks and Recreation, San Roque School, and the Natural History Museum here. Whereas children today are far less likely than past generations to spend time playing outside, a growing body of research indicates that children pay a high price for indoor lifestyles, resulting in increased childhood obesity, depression, inattentiveness, diminished creativity, and a disconnect to the natural world. And whereas the city of Santa Barbara can offer parents and children rich resources for exploring nature trails, city and county parks, beaches, creeks, lakes, mountain canyons, and national forests within our immediate boundaries, and whereas children who play outdoors on a regular basis are happier, healthier, smarter, more cooperative, and more self-confident, we commit to the ongoing promotion of programs, policies, and practices that will reconnect children and nature in enduring, meaningful ways. And whereas Leave No Child Inside Santa Barbara represents a growing network of individuals, organizations, and agencies, the City of Santa Barbara Parks and Recreation Department is partnering with 28 local organizations, including the Santa Barbara Museum of Natural History, Los Padres National Forest Service, Wilderness Youth Project, and the Santa Barbara Zoo, to spread the word about the importance of providing opportunities for all children to experience frequent, regular play and exploration in natural outdoor settings. And whereas professionally trained staff and volunteers at Girls Incorporated encourage girls to build skills and self-confidence through the hands-on activities and programs that let them discover their strengths in areas such as math, science, technology, sports, adventure, leadership, career planning, and life skills, now, therefore, I, Dale Francisco, on behalf of Mayor Marty Bloom, by virtue of the authority vested in me by the City of Santa Barbara, California, do hereby proclaim the month of April as Children and Nature Awareness Month, enthusiastically encourage our community members to support programs and activities that ensure our children stay in touch with our natural surroundings.
Hello, thank you very much. My name is Terry Brown. I'm the Youth Activities Supervisor, and I'm here with Kimmy Coley, Assistant Supervisor, and Andrew Lindsay. He's a local educator from San Roque School. And we've been attending the consortium meetings for about the last 18 months. And Elaine Gibson from the Natural History Museum, who couldn't be here, has really been spearheading this locally. And there's now a national website that any information on No Child Left Inside can be found at.
SantaBarbaraWild.org,
one word. And it's been a pleasure to be on this committee. I've been involved with Nature Camp with the Parks and Recreation Department for 25 years. And truly, the kids get as dirty as you could possibly imagine. And that's been the biggest barrier for parents when they bring their kids to camp, they're like, will my child come home dirty? And I say, absolutely. And they're like, ah, but that's the way it is, and we like it that way. So we hope that everybody appreciates what we're doing as a committee, and we will continue to keep children outside. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Item 3, proclamation celebrating the commissioning of the USS Stockdale.
Hi. Whereas USS Stockdale, DDG 106, an Arleigh Burke-class guided missile destroyer, is the first ship of the United States Navy to be named for Vice Admiral James Bond Stockdale, a Medal of Honor recipient and one of the Navy's most highly decorated officers. And whereas the motto of USS Stockdale, Return with Honor, reminds us of Admiral Stockdale's extraordinary service and sacrifice during 7 years as the Navy's senior prisoner of war in North Vietnam, exemplifying the Navy's highest values of courage and perseverance. And whereas USS Stockdale will be commissioned this Saturday, April 18, 2009, at Naval Base Ventura County, Port Hueneme, and whereas the men and women of USS Stockdale proudly represent the core values of honor, courage, and commitment of the United States Navy and are always welcome in the community of Santa Barbara, now, therefore, I, Dale Francisco, on behalf of Mayor Marty Bloom and by virtue of the authority vested in me as Mayor Pro Tem of the City of Santa Barbara, California, do hereby salute and commend the officers and crew of USS Stockdale, congratulate them on the commissioning of the Navy's newest and most advanced destroyer, and extend to them our wholehearted support and appreciation for all that they endeavor. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Karen Crawford. I'm the president of the Santa Barbara Navy League, and this is Doug Crawford, our vice president and public affairs officer. Thank you so much for this proclamation. It's going to mean a lot to the ship and to the crew. We will be presenting it on Friday evening. We've got a number of exciting events that are happening in Naval Base Ventura County, and we are so honored that the Secretary of the Navy selected our council to co-host this commissioning with Naval Base Ventura County. It's truly an honor because all naval officers, when they are at school, learn who Admiral Stockdale was. He is their mentor then and now because of his courageous actions in the Hanoi prison camps. So truly, we were just giddy to find out that we were going to be able to commission it, and now it's coming to be. And we are excited about the few activities that are going to be in Santa Barbara and those that are going to be in Ventura. But no, we are adopting the ship. So this ship will be coming to town, and we're looking forward to it. Mr. Crawford is going to add a few events details.
Yes, thank you. The reason that the Secretary of the Navy contacted the Santa Barbara Navy League is because the admirals in the Pentagon say that Santa Barbara is the favorite destination for the United States Navy in the world. And the spirit of this city is so well exemplified whenever a sailor walks on the street or a Marine or any other individual in uniform. And it stands to the credit of the city of Santa Barbara and the people that lead this city and the businesses that are here and the citizens. We have over 100 sailors that will be delivered to Santa Barbara this evening. The first thing they wanted to do was don't plan anything for us, just let us get to know Santa Barbara. So they'll be on State Street from 6 to 9 tonight and again on Thursday. We thank you so much for the city's proclamation. The reason I'm dressed up like this, I don't normally dress like this, is I just came from the windy, cold deck of the ship. It just pulled into Port Hueneme. The sailors and the crew asked us to send up their warmest regards and many, many thanks to the city of Santa Barbara for all you've done for the Navy. We do have tickets available. Navy League members are invited. We have to ask you to come to the Santa Barbara Navy League office at 402 East Gutierrez, where we do have tickets available. And we'd love to have you there. We're expecting about 6,000 people. And the wonderful thing that is going to be happening here is you know what's been happening with the pirates. The ship that helped eliminate that problem is a Stockdale-class ship. the idea that the commanding officer of CENTCOM, who is General Petraeus's boss, is coming to speak to this event is huge. The fact that H. Ross Perot, who is one of our greatest patriots in America and a man who knows how to eliminate, or how, let me put it a different way, knows how to extricate our people from Iran, if you remember, on the wall of his office is a little white piece of paper that hangs up as you walk out amidst all this beautiful art. It says, Perot 2, Iran 0. So from a point of history to a point of the present, we ask that everyone welcome them, say thank you, and we'd love to have as many of our citizens join this historic event as could possibly attend. Thank you very much.
I would like to leave some brochures for you so that you can learn more about Admiral Stocksale's life. Thank you so much.
Mr. Armstrong, are there any changes to the agenda?
There are no changes, Mayor Francisco.
We will now have public comment. We have a technology failure here at the dais, and the timer is out of commission. So we will be using more primitive methods today. I will time the 2 minutes, and when we get within 15 seconds of concluding, I'll raise my hand so you know your time is up. Our first speaker will be Fred Coleman, followed by Kate Smith.
Hello, Council. I was trying to figure out what this funding is. Human Services is one of them. CDBG Capital is another one. Home is another one. Human Services funding is another one. CDBG, I mentioned that one. RDA Capital, HELP, which helped build the Creole that I live at. Do you know who these fundings are coming from?
Yes.
Okay, so who is HELP?
Mr. Francisco.
Mr. Coleman, if you could just make your comment, I'd be happy to talk with you after the meeting in more detail.
Okay. I have a doctor's appointment, but...
Feel free to call me anytime.
Thank you. Can I have your card?
Yes. Please ask the city administrator.
Mayor Francisco, I think Mr. Casey in the back can answer all those questions
Great.
For Mr. Coleman right now.
Perfect. After Kate Smith will be Councilor and Mayor Paul Giuliano.
Santa Barbara City Council, please give me a moment to announce that we have a foreign dignitary with us today. Paul Giuliano is here with his family from Victoria, Australia. Paul is the mayor of Mooney Ponds and the leader of the Mooney Valley City Council, right here, with his family in beautiful Santa Barbara. Australia sent the largest contingent of marchers to the Great Peace March for Global Nuclear Disarmament. So welcome from Australia to our beautiful city. Now, I wanted to speak on the two items, Autism Awareness Month and the Awareness of Children and Nature Proclamation, but I've been told that you do not accept public comments on ceremonial items. So I will just mention that Marsha Eichelberger is well known in the nation for leading autism awareness, and I hope you took her words to heart. She threw down the gauntlet. There is systematic and systemic violation of state and federal law, and I have been talking about this fact for several years. So I would like to read. In the 21st century, American resistance to genuine education reform is a self-indulgence that threatens the nation. The first step in achieving real education reform is a sober recognition of the phalanx of opposing forces. It's a virtual great wall.
15 seconds.
Teacher and administrator unions and associations, as well as a variety of professional education associations who see education reform as a threat to their personal and professional comfort. The plethora of commercial interests who fear education reform would disrupt their profits as suppliers to schools. Laws on the local, state, and national levels designed to thwart real and true substantive education reform. Apathy on the part of too many.
Thank you, Ms. Smith.
The last sentence. And an American cultural resistance to any substantive change in the way our schools are structured and operated.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mayor Giuliano.
Thank you very much, and I do apologize. I'd hoped that this could be a lot more informal. I didn't mean to disrupt your council meeting today. And it's good to see
No disruption at all.
Well, it's good to see your technical difficulties don't limit themselves to Santa Barbara. We have plenty of those ourselves. So. And I do apologize for my attire, but the only suit I did have has been in my luggage for the last 3 weeks and doesn't look all that flush at the moment. Basically, we've been sending our correspondence to California in relation to our bushfires because we've had quite a vast amount of devastation throughout Victoria with our bushfires. And I've also got newspapers for you to have a look at. It's not a plea for money. It's basically just to inform you of what's happening outside of California and what's happened and the amount of devastation that's happened in Victoria and quite possibly to create a friendship city. We have three other friendship cities across the world, and it has nothing to do with money. It's more educational purposes. We have officer exchange. We call our council staff officers, and we send them across the world as well. And it's exchanging ideas, thoughts, and so on. Sorry?
No, go ahead.
And that's basically what a friendship city is all about. So that's what I've come here for today. And also just to make you aware of some of the areas devastated in Victoria are quite severe. We've had over 500 deaths, thousands and thousands of livestock, animals, rare animals, native fauna that will never grow back, and so on. So the devastation has been quite vast and extensive. So I also have some gifts to give you because of all the councils that we wrote to across California, I think you were the only ones that responded. So it was incredible.
Well, thank you very much for coming, Mayor. No. A couple of council members would like to speak.
I wanted to tell you that we have a long and active sister city program here, and that's what we call it. I think it sounds pretty similar to what you're suggesting. And from our side, there's a set of application forms and so on, which my office could help you with. If you're around after the meeting, we'd be happy to let you know what sort of application process we go through. And it seems like it would be a good connection, and I'd be happy to work with you on that. So thanks for mentioning it.
No, not a problem. It'll have to be by mail because we're catching a plane in a couple of hours. So. But thank you very much for having me. And I also, with the gifts, they are promotional items. We have a register as councillors in our city. We have to have a dollar figure attached to them. There is no dollar figure attached to these. So I don't know whether you have a register as well for gifts. So it is $0 value because they are promotional items.
Okay.
Okay. So thank you very, very much for having us today. And
thank you for being here.
I do appreciate it.
And
thank you.
Mr. Francisco, if I may.
Safe trip home.
Mr. House.
Yes, Mayor Giuliano, and I just thought it might be an opportune time for you to introduce your family. I saw you as you came in, and I was thinking, what a wonderful group of tourists here in Santa Barbara. and then I read your card later and went, oh, my goodness, it ran out after you, and you had already gone. And I was thinking, what a real joy to have you come here. We've had our problems with fire, and the fact that we share this as a concern is something that really does bond our two cities and our two communities. And so I think it's just really wonderful that you've come. But you've got a great family. We'd like to get to know them a little bit. So.
Well, that's my wife, Deborah, and that's my eldest son, Marcus, and that's my youngest son, Matthew.
Well, we're really hoping you're enjoying our city. I'm sorry you can't stay longer, but really come back again and hang out with us.
I will. But may I be so bold as to say that all the places we've been to, right from the West Coast, we've now done four states, which is California, Nevada, Arizona, Utah. This is the most beautiful city, and I'm not degrading any other city we've visited. We've been from San Francisco to LA to San Diego. This is probably the best city, and if we were to choose to live somewhere in America, it would be Santa Barbara. Let me tell you, it is gorgeous. It is a beautiful, beautiful city, and congratulations to you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Enjoy your stay.
Our next speaker will be Hans Kistner, followed by Richard Robinson. Is Mr. Kistner here?
Yes. I'm just letting these folks get out peacefully. I'm here as a dad, four kids, to say thank you to the city for the zoo, for the parks and rec programs, and for Kids World that was mentioned earlier behind me. And my kids and my family enjoy what the city provides very much. I'm also here today as pastor of First Baptist Church and representing a few Christian communities that pray for the city council daily and weekly throughout the year. And I came to pray that you would be good. Same prayer that I pray for myself. But in regard to that kind of good, I'm thinking of Proverbs 13 that says, "The good will leave an inheritance to their children's children." And so I wanted to come and pray this prayer for you, that Almighty God, you would anoint our council with foresight and vision and a tenderness of heart toward the children of this city, that their children would be blessed because of the choices that we make today. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks.
Thank you. Our next speaker will be Richard Robinson, followed by George Green.
Honorable Mayor Pro Tem, members, Walt Disney Studios has a remake of Witch Mountain at Metropolitan Theater Corp's Fiesta 5 Theaters 916 State. In theater number one, Race to Witch Mountain. Because there are other films in Fiesta 5 which are not Jack Valenti's rated them restricted, I caution that the kids not be allowed to run around that theater because they will sneak into a film that's not appropriate. Thank you. It's which Gary Marshall's stars in this film. It's a good film. If you have any munchkins, send them because we need the revenue. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was our last speaker. Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Green, sorry.
Yeah, my name's George Green. I'm the organizing director and senior field rep for SEIU Local 620, and wanted to speak today briefly about, and I understand I only got 2 minutes, so I just wanted to give you guys an update on what is going on between SEIU Local 620 and the City of Santa Barbara. I'm chief spokesperson at the bargaining table for the general unit employees. The general unit employees, who we are, you know, you heard some folks talking about, the brother who gave us the prayer was talking about thanking you for the recreation programs in the city. We're the recreation department, we're the parks department, we're the library, we're the streets, et cetera, et cetera. We're your large miscellaneous unit, and other than the temporary employees, the lowest paid unit in the city of Santa Barbara. I think folks know that, we've been in negotiations and discussions with the city. We were asked by the city of Santa Barbara to enter into negotiations over furloughs, salary concessions, etc. Our understanding was we were being asked to bargain over that to mitigate and or do away with layoffs. We understand that the city is in a serious financial situation and that there's a serious revenue challenge with regard to revenues versus expenditures. You know, we had no obligation to come in and bargain with the city over salary concessions or furloughs or any of that stuff. But, you know, our membership, our leadership, our elected leaders thought that it would be a good idea. Just a quick overview again. I've only got 2 minutes, so I'm going to be careful what I go into.
15 seconds, Mr. Green.
15 seconds? Okay. A quick overview of our proposal. We've offered up more than $1.2 million in salary concessions to the city, and I won't go into all of what that is. What we've asked for in turn for that is a guarantee of no layoffs to our membership for the duration of the fiscal year. We're no longer negotiating with the city of Santa Barbara. As of last week, we went into a bargaining session last week, and we're told that the city has a legal opinion that we cannot negotiate furloughs or salary concessions in order to get no layoffs for the fiscal year, that's somehow illegal.
Mr. Green, could you please conclude?
I will conclude, and I want to hand something out because I'm going to read something really quickly. Liebert and Cassidy, which you pay a lot of money to give you advice on collective bargaining and labor relations generally, put out a special bulletin on employee furloughs to public employers February 6 of 2009. And my last thing is this sentence and the answer. The question, and these are common employer questions to Liebert, Cassidy, and Whitmore, why would a union ever willingly agree to furloughs? And the answer from Liebert, Cassidy, and Whitmore is, the most common quid pro quo for agreeing to furloughs is the promise of no layoffs for a period of time. Often such a promise is attractive enough in tough economic times to persuade a union to accept furloughs. So I'm going to hand these out and ask that council reconsider their legal position on not being able to enter into an agreement with our union about layoffs in exchange for salary concessions. We're still willing, you know, our $1.2 million offer is not a last, best, and final offer, but we're not going to recommend to our membership that they give up significant salary concessions without getting anything in return. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Green. We now have the consent calendar. Ms. Check, would you read items 7 and 14?
Item 7, records destruction for airport department, recommending that council adopt by reading of title only a resolution of the council of the city of Santa Barbara relating to the destruction of records held by the airport department in the administration office.
Okay, very good. Sorry about that.
I'll move consent calendar.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you. Report from the Finance Committee, Mr. Horton.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. The Finance Committee met today at 12:30. We discussed a number of items, most of which we've already covered in consent. And we have a suggestion for the council, which will come up in a later presentation dealing with airport financing. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, on to item 13.
Set a date for a public hearing regarding appeals of Architectural Board of Review preliminary approval for 1298 Coast Village Road.
Very good. And we have one public comment. Is that Mr. Fell?
Prior to the public comment, I think the city clerk's office has just something briefly.
Oh, very good. Okay.
Mayor Pro Tem and members of council, as you know, last week we had a complaint regarding the proposed setting of this hearing for May 5th. And subsequent to that, we were given 3 dates to work with to try to resolve this, those dates being May 5, June 9, and June 23. And after extensive contact with all three parties to this appeal, we did reach agreement on Friday to set this hearing for June 23rd at 6 p.m. And so our recommendation to you is that you set that date and time for this hearing.
Very good. Thank you, Ms. Jack. Mr. Fell.
Okay. I'm Doug Fell, and I'm here representing the owner of the property, which is the subject of this appeal hearing, which is Olive Oil and Gas Company. Basically, Jeff Gorell agreed to the June 23rd, 20, third date because he didn't think he had any choice. And I'm here to tell you this whole system is not fair. We got an ABR approval in February 23rd, 2009. And what we're being told is we're not going to have a hearing until June 23rd, 2009. That's 4 months. And it wasn't, I mean, May 5th was just great, and all of a sudden somebody shows up and says that date doesn't work for me. But, and then you work through all the dates, and it went from May 5th all the way to June 23rd. And we just don't think it's fair. This whole idea that everybody has to work together is a good, it sounds good, but when someone is really, if you will, your opponent, and they are opposed to your project and have tried to oppose your project from the day it started through the process, and we're here now with appealing the ABR decision, we just think we deserve a little bit better treatment and would rather have it be on May 5th as was originally proposed.
Thank you, Mr. Fell. Mr. Williams.
I do have a question of how these dates were chosen, because I believe I made a motion last time that the date that we would entertain other dates before June, and two of these three dates are after June. And so I'm just not sure why this course of action is such as it was after the motion was clearly dates before June.
And our problem was we were trying to have a full council, which different parties wanted to have. And we've got two council members that have dates that they're going to be gone. And then when we focused on June the 2nd, we could not get agreement on June the 2nd, and then we started looking at other dates available on the council, and then we looked at the June the 9th, and we couldn't get agreement by the three parties, and then we finally got June the 23rd. We were happy with May the 5th, but unfortunately Mr. Fisher had not gotten back to us, and so our general method is we try and get agreement by all the parties on a date. And June the 23rd was the first date when we had a full council, we had an open date, and all three parties would agree to it.
So there is no date in May besides the 5th that all council members will be at?
No. And with a lot of effort went into just trying to get the parties to agree to this.
Thank you, Mr. Armstrong.
Can I just ask why June 9th was not agreeable to the two parties?
As I recall, Mr. Fisher, Susan? Yeah, I think Mr. Fisher was on vacation.
Yes, I do have a note here that says that Mr. Fisher, June 9th did not work for him. And also June 2nd didn't work for him either.
Like June 2nd, Mr. Fell had a problem with that date.
Correct. Yes, that's correct.
I guess I have no conclusion otherwise, other than the fact that this is collective obstructionism and maybe incompetence on all of our parts. So I'm frustrated, but I'm not sure what else to do.
Mr. House.
Just a question for you, Mr. Armstrong. Usually we have limits in terms of the time that we're allowed to, that we have to actually have a process happen with the permit streamlining and all that. Does any of that apply here? Or is it just, is it just whatever we come up with?
I'll let Steve Wiley address that. We're very sensitive, or we try to be very sensitive to not letting, especially an appellant, hang up an applicant by just delaying the process. And we try and be sensitive to that. And I think that's where, when we came to you last week on May the 5th, what had happened is we thought we had agreement. We had not heard from Mr. Fisher. There were repeated calls made to him and emails, and he never responded. And so then that was the date we recommended to you. And then, you know, he came and said that date didn't work for him. And so then we've gotten into this process. But we try and be sensitive to, you know, not allowing folks to just continue to use the appeal process to delay a project. But then we've also got your schedules that we try and work with, and then we try and, you know, the goal in almost all cases it works, that we finally reach agreement on an acceptable date, and in this case it just kept getting pushed out.
Yeah, I think the objection, the big thing that, for which I supported that motion last time, was that the question of noticing, getting somebody aware that there's a pending hearing that they would want to participate in. So May 5th, and perhaps the clerk can refresh our memory, May 5th, ultimately, once notified, once informed and asked, did not work for one of the three parties for some particular reason. Do we know what reason that is?
May 5th did not work for Mr. Fisher, and I'm not sure of the reason for that.
Well, okay. I know maybe Mr. Wiley wants to say something, but for me, just not working for someone is not sufficient. It's just the whole idea is that we process things in a timely fashion. We do the very best we possibly can, and we notify and give everybody a chance to participate and get involved. For me, I think the spirit of this kind of got missed in there, and you've done the best you can from the staff's perspective, but I think that the original date of May 5th seems like it's available. We don't have any absolute reasons. Somebody's not going to be out of town or, you know, away or something, and I have a very hard time pushing this back an extra month. We had said June 2nd was the deadline, and we were looking for a date in that time frame, which to me was stretching it to the limit. And if there's nothing up to, you know, after May 5th that we can get, then I tend to want to come back to May 5th. I really don't like this approach to dealing with appeals. I don't mean from the staff's perspective, but it makes it really bad for everyone. Mr. Wiley, are we going over a line with stretching this all the way to June 23rd?
Well, Mr. Mayor, Councilmember House, first to answer your question about the Permit Streamlining Act, that does not apply here because that applies to entitlements, to development review, and this is design review. And, of course, as design review, it's a city process. There's no state laws involved. But I think at the same time, that sort of means that because, you know, the Permit Streamlining Act is designed to give applicants a fairly expeditious process, that the city ought to keep that sort of thing in mind. And we've talked among ourselves at the staff level that this disagreement raises that question. In other words, a lot of the things that council does can be compared to the way judges handle things, the way the court process does things. And I will tell you, in my experience, I've never seen a judge that would let the litigants argue about the dates and just say, well, you tell me whatever day works for you. Judges will, and this is appropriate, allow the litigants, the attorneys involved, to try to work out dates within reason. But ultimately, if they can't, and if the judge doesn't agree with that it's within a reasonable time, the judge will say, this is the date, you either be there or you have someone from your office there. And that's when it's going to happen. And I think I mentioned that because at times the council, it's fully appropriate and fair for the council to do that. And I think what I'm saying is what we've been saying, that our primary concern would be the council schedule, that if it's something that it looks like it should appropriately have all seven council members, that's our first concern. And then secondarily, to try to make the process fair and expeditious for applicants.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Wiley. You know, and to the rest of the council, I just want to say I think that because of our need to have, we think it's important to have all seven of us here if we possibly can do it. I think stretching it to June 23rd, even though there was a tentative agreement that seems to have come to bear, I think that misses the entire point. We should not allow this to drag on that far. And so I would move that we set the date for May 5th.
Mayor Francisco, just because I want to make sure we're fair to Mr. Fisher, before you vote on this. I did see Mr. Fisher at the beginning of this meeting. I didn't, at that point, Mr. Fell wasn't here, and he asked me if there was going to be discussion on this, and I told him that my understanding was is that all three parties had agreed to the 23rd, and he said, well, then I won't stay and speak. So I just so you understand that we had that conversation.
I appreciate that, Mr. Armstrong.
I think Tony Fisher may still be available if we want to put this over for a little bit.
Okay, let's table the item and take it after item 14.
Mr. Mayor, I'll withdraw my motion and move to table this until perhaps a little later in our meeting today.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Item 14.
Introduction of ordinance for amendments to the 2007 Fire Code, recommending that council introduce and subsequently adopt by reading of title only an ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara amending subsection E of section 804020 and subsection C and D of section 2204020 of the Santa Barbara Municipal Code concerning local requirements for the installation of automatic fire sprinklers.
Please go ahead.
Mayor Pro Tem and members of the City Council, Joe Pori, Santa Barbara City Fire Marshal, and Nikki Stute, Inspector 2 for the Fire Department. We're here today to introduce the update to the sprinkler ordinance. Many of you know that we already have a sprinkler ordinance that was adopted with the 2007 Fire Code, and that was something that you adopted last year and went into effect as of the 1st of January in 2008. We held these sections back originally so that we would have a more time to publicly demonstrate what we wanted to do with the sprinkler ordinance. We didn't feel when we adopted the 2007 code that we had enough time to explain it all and have some input from stakeholders, and that was why the delay. These were originally intended for adoption with the 2007 fire code. So the proposed modification will amend the Municipal Code Chapter 804 and the adopting ordinance of the Fire Code. And as I was saying, it was originally written to coincide with the sections that were adopted on January 1 of 2008. Contains requirements for residential sprinklers in single-family homes and for all new construction, commercial and residential. The California Fire Code that you adopted with local amendments was adopted under Ordinance 5439, and as part of the adoption process, these sprinkler requirements were written. They were written to correspond with surrounding jurisdictions and many jurisdictions throughout the state of California that already have this type of sprinkler ordinance. And the reason why is because sprinklers save lives and property. 78% of all structure fires occur in residential property, including in the city of Santa Barbara. They account for most of the deaths and most of the firefighter deaths. Residential sprinklers respond very quickly. They control or extinguish the fire, preventing what we call flashover. They often complete their work before the fire department arrives, so they're very effective means of controlling a fire at what we call its incipient stage. That is, getting it before it starts to get out of hand and is a situation where we have to come in and dump copious amounts of water to put the fire out. And it has been shown statistically that 63%, there's a 63% reduction with smoke detectors in a home. That increased to 82% with the addition of fire sprinklers and smoke detectors. And to demonstrate, this is kind of a timetable that shows the various responses of sprinklers. If you look at the chart, the activation of sprinklers occur within those two arcs, the red and the blue arc. If you look at the far side of the curve, it takes approximately 8 minutes for the fire department to get to from the start of a smoke alarm until the final application of water. Generally, there's a delay between a minute, 2 minutes before the fire department is called, and then it takes a certain amount of time to get dispatched. If it's in the middle of the night, it takes a certain amount of time to get ready, get out of the fire station. Generally, in this jurisdiction, we have about a four-minute response time to any given call in the city. And then there's setup time, hooking up to hydrants and so forth. During that time, the fire continues to grow, and I'll show you a video in a second that demonstrates that. Fires tend to grow very quickly in ordinary combustibles, the types of things like furniture and those things that are in compartment fires, in house fires. So the idea behind sprinklers is that they control that at a very early stage as opposed to waiting for that lag time. They also warn the occupants because there's usually a bell associated with sprinklers. They've been known to prevent loss of life by preventing flashover. And I'll give you an example of flashover in this video. This was originally created by someone we've worked with. His name is Dan Majakowski, and he works for NIST, which is the National Institute of Standards and Technology, a federal agency. And they did this demonstration several years ago. And this Christmas tree in an ordinary and sparsely furnished room brings this room to flashover in less than a minute. And this would be your typical living room situation. If this was your only exit out, you would probably have to cross through this room at some point in the fire, and the atmosphere in this room becomes untenable within a minute. So if this is in the middle of the night, the Christmas tree will then set the couch and then set the chair on fire, but the room will be very close to flashover. And as you can see, 37 seconds, 38 seconds have gone by, and the fire is growing at a pretty typical rate. In a second, the smoke layer will ignite. It just did. And about 38 seconds into this fire, that room would not have been able to cross. You would not have been able to cross that room and live to tell about it. So NIST set up a second experiment, and this one shows the application of one single residential head. They flow about 20 gallons per minute, which is not particularly a lot of water, but you'll see this sprinkler head in the ceiling in the upper left-hand corner goes off right now, 9 seconds into the film. And we won't run this entire piece of video, but I can tell you, you can see the water coming down in that upper left-hand shot. As the fire goes on, you can see that it's still burning at the moment, but the cooling effect of this sprinkler head is going to dampen it down to the point, and ultimately, within 4 minutes, it's going to put this fire out. But the important thing is, if you look at the smoke layer, particularly on the door on the lower right-hand side, this room is, you are still able to crawl out of this room if you need to get out of the house. And the interesting thing about the end of that video is that the only thing that sustains severe damage in the video with the application of the sprinkler is the Christmas tree itself. There's minor damage to the couch, there's minor damage to the chair, but if you notice the table with a lamp on it in the chair, over on the left-hand side, at the end of the fire, when the sprinkler puts the entire thing out, the lamp is still on, so the electricity hasn't thrown, the breakers haven't thrown, and the sprinkler has been very effective. Two examples of effectiveness of residential sprinklers locally. We had a fire in the 4200 block of Kyrielle. It was brand-new construction, happened to be a sprinkler building, residential. It was human-caused, accidental. And it was a contents fire. It had nothing to do with the building, infrastructure, or any other part of a fault, like electrical or anything like that. The victim was on a burning mattress. The fire was controlled by a sprinkler above, and the victim was unconscious at the time. This absolutely would have ended up in a fatality had there not been a residential sprinkler present. In the end, it resulted in minor injuries and very minor damage. As you can see on the wall, on the far side, that's pretty much the extent of the whole structure damage. And this would have been a fire that would have resulted like the one you saw with the Christmas tree. In another one, this is a brand new piece of property, not occupied yet. The room was visqueened off for painting purposes, and someone inadvertently left a burner on the stove. But the sprinkler system was up and active. And the sprinkler system, in spite of the burning plastic, controlled and extinguished the fire before we got there. The United States Fire Administration has taken the position that they support residential sprinklers and have been promoting it actively. So I'd like to address some of the sprinkler myths and facts. A lot of people believe that all sprinklers go off at once. That's not true. Sprinklers go off because they're fused. There's an element that reacts to temperature in each individual head. So when heat is applied to that element, it releases that head and that head only. They don't go off by the application of smoke. It has to be heat. And as far as causing excessive water damage, you saw the sprinkler in the video that was putting out about 20 gallons per minute. When we show up, we generally put out about 300 to 400 gallons per minute. So if it gets to the point where the fire department has to put the fire out, we're causing significantly more water damage, and of course there would be a lot more fire damage. Sprinklers are expensive. In the course of our public meetings on this, we did talk to the NFPA and other authorities on the subject, and we found that they had $1.61 per square foot for sprinkler costs. We were challenged by some of the stakeholders, and rightfully so. It turns out that in Santa Barbara, the costs are higher than that because construction costs are generally higher than that. But nationally, it's 1% of the cost of a home. In Santa Barbara, the local range is from $2.25 to $3.50 per square foot. And that's for example, a 2,500 square foot home at $3 a square foot, it would equal about $7,500, which is still less than 1% of the cost of the home. Insurance offsets generally range between 2 and 20%. Another myth is that sprinklers are ugly. Sprinklers can be concealed, and in fact, they often are. A good example that I'll show you in a minute are our own Granada theater. And I would like to address the, will they help in the event of a fire like the Tea Fire? And these sprinklers are not intended to address an incident like the Tea Fire. These are internal fires, the type you saw in the video. They will probably be overwhelmed in most cases by a fire like the Tea Fire. So this is a different issue. However, it would prevent a home that's about to flash over from becoming the start of a fire like the Tea Fire. And examples of concealed heads, I have arrows pointing to them. That's the Granada Theater. And the head in the ceiling there is pretty artfully concealed. As you can see, it almost looks like part of the decoration. They can be made by the manufacturer to match whatever paint color you're putting up or whatever decorative applications you have. So the proposed amendments, they'll require sprinklers in all new construction, including single-family residences, except for certain detached utility buildings. They'll require sprinklers in single-family residential remodels and additions that are greater than 50% of the square footage or of greater than 1,000 square feet. They require sprinklers throughout the building in commercial remodels that are greater than 50% of the total square footage. And previously we had this at 25%. When we were having the stakeholder meetings, one of the architects who came to the meeting suggested that we change the 25% to 50%. We agreed that in the case of the 25%, it might be a burden on the lessee who was remodeling a structure, and that 50% was more fair, so we changed it at their request. And will require sprinklers in any existing building when the use of the building changes to a more hazardous occupancy. An example of that would be a retail store that becomes a nightclub. Installation standards will be according to national standards. NFPA 13 is a commercial standard, and 13R and 13D are both for residential. The 13D is the critical one here because that is the one that controls residential in single-family homes and duplexes. 13D systems run off domestic water. You don't have to tap the water main. You don't have to trench a line to the house. They come off domestic water. They have their own little backflow device. And generally speaking, domestic water supplies plenty of water for those systems. So how do they compare? Currently, in the commercial, sprinklers are required in new construction that are greater than 5,000 square feet. In the proposed, the sprinklers will be required in all new construction. In the commercial additions, any addition to a building over 5,000 square feet, you have to retroactively sprinkler the entire building. And again, any addition to a building will trigger the sprinkler requirement. Change of use to a building to a more hazardous occupancy in a building over 5,000 square feet is the existing. And in the new, any change in occupancy that results in a more hazardous occupancy, no matter what the square footage is, will require sprinklers. And remodels to existing buildings don't trigger any sprinkler requirements at this point, but remodels to existing buildings involving greater than 50% of the existing square footage will under these proposed ordinance. And in the residential, sprinklers are currently not required in any single-family home construction. In the proposed, the NFPA 13D sprinklers, the ones that are operated off domestic water, will be required in all new single families and duplexes. Additions and alterations, also sprinklers are currently not required, but additions to buildings involving greater than 50% or greater than 1,000 square feet in future remodels will be required. And to prevent what we call serial remodeling, in other words, remodeling one small piece at a time, there's language in the codes that basically addresses that, that all remodels account to the aggregate. So we believe that the sprinkler enhancements will provide a greater protection. They're supported by the state of California, by the National Fire Administration, and, of course, by just about every fire department anywhere. We believe they save lives and property, so we're asking for your vote to pass these amendments forward.
Thank you, Mr. Poiret. As we have no request from the public to speak, this is to the council. Mr. Horton?
Joe, in the staff report, you mentioned that on page 2, I believe, that there are insurance rebates available for some types of construction. I'm particularly concerned with the nonprofit community. And are you aware of any insurance advantages for that type of a structure, such as a boys' club or something like that?
Mayor Pro Tem, Councilmember Horton, I think they're the same. I think they apply the same, and it depends on the insurance carrier. They all vary quite a bit. In fact, that wide disparity that we found, 2% to 20%, is kind of telling of the insurance industry. But I think that they would apply that to nonprofits the same way they would apply it to commercial.
Ms. Schneider.
Thank you. Well, this seems like a no-brainer to me, and I appreciate the background information and actually getting the myths out there, because I think, you know, the issue about it being ugly, or, you know, it shouldn't deter us from having a safe place. So I'm happy to move this ordinance forward.
Second. More discussion? Mr. Williams.
I was just going to say that it's, you know, we looked at this in ordinance committee, and I felt like we were aware of the fact that this does mean a real cost to people. But the fact is that the lives that it'll save, really, we cannot put a cost on. And so I'm pleased to support it.
Mr. House, did you have further comments?
Yes, I did. I support the motion, and I wanted to say one of the things you mentioned today, and when we were in ordinance committee, you framed it a little bit differently, but I think it's important for the public, and that is that when you watch the movies and you see the a smoke-filled room of some sort, and I guess there's a lot of humor made of this, that all the sprinklers go off and it causes great damage and it's all hilarious or something in some of these movies, but that's just not the way it works, and I think that that's a fear that people have about the idea of installing a sprinkler system. And from what I've gotten from what you told us in ordinance and today again, this is very localized in terms of its impact and its response. And that's accurate, right? Where the heat element itself right at one of those sprinklers does not take over the whole room, and I think it's important to emphasize that.
Councilmember House, I'm glad you brought that
take
up.
Take over the whole
that
house.
That is an accurate statement. When that single head does go off, it only dumps about 20 gallons per minute, which is relatively low, but in almost every case, we'll control the fire long enough for us to get there. But again, that's correct. Hollywood has kind of hurt us a little bit in the fire business in the sprinkler industry, because they give the impression that all of the sprinklers go off at once, and that just doesn't happen.
Okay, very good. And I think there may be some folks who, once they, with sort of an educational piece to this, understand the value of it, may want to retrofit their own homes to do that. And certainly there's other structures that could benefit from this that don't have it already. So let's keep up the educational effort. And I learned a lot during this process. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I'd like to say also, as a member of the Ordinance Committee, I was initially skeptical of this regulation. I'm concerned anytime we add further to the cost of building new homes. However, as I learned more about this and also reflected on the meaning of building codes arose originally to stop fires from happening. That was the very first instances of building codes. Building codes in general exist to promote public health and safety. And it's always a tough decision to make how much is too much. But building codes have also advanced due to advancing knowledge. And our greater knowledge of earthquakes, for instance, has changed the building code with regard to structural integrity, and our better understanding of fires has continually changed the building code with respect to fire safety. So I eventually came to the conclusion that this actually was a good proposal, and I think this is something that we will look back on and say it was a good idea. So with that, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you, Mr. Poirier.
Thank you very much.
We go loop back to the hearing.
We will now return to item 13. Ms. Check, could you please read that one more time?
Set a date for public hearing regarding appeals of Architectural Board of Review preliminary approval for 1298 Coast Village Road.
Thank you.
I think the reason why we wanted to table this item was to ask Mr. Fisher explain why the 5th was unacceptable, because we already know that the 9th is unacceptable because he's on vacation.
Mr. Williams, I think you have that exactly right.
Mr. Fisher.
Mr. Fisher, would you like to approach the dais?
First time this date came up, my client said they would not be here. And that has been true ever since.
And what about
I can't proceed without my clients. They've obviously got hundreds of hours into this review of this project. We sat for another couple hours down at the Coastal Commission last week. So, you know, to May 5th was not acceptable from day one. And I've been told clearly that June 23rd was agreed upon by everybody. So I wasn't even intending to be here today. So I'm a little surprised that the question is still out there.
My question, well, first of all,
Let me make one other statement. Some of the other dates that were suggested, I was told were not acceptable. And when I asked, could somebody tell me why not, I was told that the other side didn't have to give a reason. So it just seemed like maybe we weren't playing fair. I have to give a reason, justify why I can't be here, but other dates got vetoed without there being a reason, such as June 2nd. So when we got to June 23rd, I thought, fine, we've resolved the problem. Let's go forward. I'll, in fact, be only in town about 30 hours before that hearing starts. So it's not convenient for me either, but I agreed to do it because it looked like it was a solution. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wilkin.
I did have a question on that. Mr. Fisher?
Mr. Williams, go ahead.
There was a motion to, before you got here, and the reason why we tabled it is we wanted you to be able to give us input. There was a motion to make it the 5th. Is the 5th worse than the 9th? Or, I mean, which one is worse?
We're talking 23rd.
I
9th, I'm in Virginia. My daughter's expecting a baby within days of that day. I'm going to be in Richmond, Virginia. I won't be here. Makes it impossible for me.
Okay.
And I bought the tickets after I was told June 2nd was okay. So, which also happens to not be a favored date for me to have a hearing, and I'll tell you later why. It doesn't have to be on the public record.
I'm not sure how we should handle it. I mean, the way that Mr. Wiley is speaking, since this is a quasi-judicial matter of where if a judge doesn't feel like the two parties can come together on a date, the judge just
picks a date.
Mr. Williams.
So I guess that's the only thing I could think of that we should do. I'm not sure which date we should pick, but I think we should pick a date.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. Would any other council member like to speak on this? Ms. Schneider.
Thank you. I guess my concern is the motion last week was very specific, and the reason why I voted for it, and I think we all did, was because it had an end date of June 2nd. And so what's being brought back to us is not, it doesn't address what the motion said. So I don't know if, I mean, the micromanagement up here is getting a little absurd, but I don't know if anyone only looked at Tuesdays. I mean, I know there are 2 weeks where at least one council member is out of town. I know we have budget hearings. But it seems to me, I got to say, 4 months after an approval to have to wait for an appeal doesn't seem fair, and we're just trying to be as fair as we can to all parties involved and to go through these little minutiae numbers when trying to be fair to everybody on an issue that's very contentious is kind of weird up here. But I do want to acknowledge the actual motion that was made last week, which was to have an end date of June 2nd, if that helps us at all.
Thank you, Ms. Schneider. Mr. Williams.
With that, that's a very good point. And with that, I think that we should ask staff next week to bring back a date, even if it's a special council election, with an end date of June 2nd. And if it ends up being a Wednesday or a Thursday, we're just going to need to have the parties do it. And if we have to pick a time when not all the parties are available, then that's what we'll have to do. So I'll just make a motion that we table this for a week, and we ask staff to bring a date before June 2nd.
By the end of the day of June 2nd, we should have a hearing. Okay?
Thank you, Mr. Williams. Okay. What I have to say about this, seeing no other lights on. Mr. Williams, as far as I'm concerned, we asked staff to come up with a date, and I realize that we gave them a desirable deadline. As far as I know, staff did their best to reach a date that worked with the schedules both of council members, and unfortunately this time of year is frequently a time when people are away, as well as the applicant and the appellants. What I was told, what I read in the report, was that staff had reached such an agreement with all the parties involved. And since I think we've spent enough of our time and staff time on this already, I would prefer to go with the staff recommendation. But in any case, any more discussion? Mr. Horton.
Yeah, when we get out that late, if it's not going to be a Tuesday, I'm going to have a fairly busy calendar. So I can't guarantee that I'll be here if it's not on a Tuesday. The recommendation was that it be on any day. I can't go along with that.
Well, it will be a Tuesday.
There's no reason why it would have to be a Tuesday unless, what folks are going to do is look at Mr. Horton's schedule and look at when we can get all the council members here and when we can get the parties here, which is the difficulty of trying to get 10 different or 11 different people's schedules to sync up.
Okay. Well, in any case,
and if we can't do that, then we're going to have to make the choice of somebody not being there.
We have a motion on the table. All those in favor?
Excuse me. Could we restate the motion, please?
Certainly.
The motion was that we table it and ask staff to come back with a date next week, even if it's not a Tuesday, that we can get as many of the parties there as possible on or before June 2nd.
Can we hear from staff on the feasibility of doing that before we vote?
We can do extraordinary efforts. I'm pretty confident it will not be on a Tuesday, so it will have to be another day of the week. We've got a council member that's not around on May the 12th, another one on May the 19th. So I don't know what their schedules are, if that's the full week, but we can go through everybody's calendars. And look for dates when the council members are here, and then we'll meet with the three parties or get together with the three parties and try and come up with a date. I mean, and I do want to recognize, we knew that your motion said before June the 2nd. We couldn't find one, thinking it would be on a Tuesday. And we thought if we had mutual agreement by all the parties that June the 23rd would work. And at that point, Mr. Fell had indicated that was an acceptable date. But if you want us to go back and you're willing to do it on a day other than a Tuesday, then we can try and make it happen.
Just a suggestion, and I don't know off the top of my head, with the various budget hearings that we have in the month of May, some of those might be on a Tuesday. We could flip-flop that to another day if Tuesday is some magic day to have an appeal. But I know we have a Monday, evening hearing for budgets. We have some in the mornings on another day. I mean, there are things we're doing in May outside of Tuesday afternoons. We have Tuesday mornings too. Instead of having an evening session, it could be a morning session. I think, you know, the parameters of what staff was trying to do in normal circumstances, they were looking at a small window, and I think we just need to expand the window, because I think it's fair to adhere to the original motion, which was through June 2nd. So I think it's doable.
Thank you, Ms. Schneider. Well, we have the motion on the table. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. Okay. Item 15.
Kachuma Conservation Release Board draft budget.
Ms. Bjork.
Good afternoon, Mayor Pro Tem, members of council. I'm Rebecca Bjork. I'm the Water Resources Manager for the City of Santa Barbara. The item before you is to receive any comments or input on the draft budget for the Kachuma Conservation Release Board. The city is a member of a joint powers authority, which is the CCRB, which is tasked with managing the city's water rights in the Kachuma project. This budget that's before you allows that work to occur. A large part of the work that is done by CCRB is actually constructing projects to rehabilitate and restore fish habitat in the San Ynez Rivershed and watershed. And in fact, a significant portion of this budget is dedicated to that work. The budget is fairly similar in magnitude to previous year's budgets. However, the scope of work is somewhat decreased because the cost of completing the projects has increased to a point where we've had to reduce from multiple projects in a year to one project for a planned per year. This budget is here for your input and consideration. Councilmember Williams is on the CCRB and has considered this budget and contributed to it. The process is that we will take any input from all of the different agencies that participate in CCRB. Any input they have will go back to the CCRB board for incorporation and finalization, and a final budget will be adopted by CCRB, which will then be presented for ratification later this fiscal year. If I have any questions, I'd be happy to address them.
Okay. Questions from the council?
Yes.
Mr. Horton.
Thank you. Rebecca, on page 7, I believe, I was looking at this document, and I notice on the far right column, there's a number of budget shortfalls listed. The bottom right corner is $56,368. I was wondering, how does this budget, is it impacted in the same way? I'm not sure how the revenues work, that city budgets and state budgets and federal budgets are impacted by the recession that we're in. And is it possible to put forth a budget with a deficit of this size under the agreements that are issued, or does it have to go forward as a balanced budget?
I think I should answer that because it's a very political question. We always are capable of doing balanced budgets with COME and CCRB and our water funds, for that matter, because the expenditures are directly tied to how large the water rates are. And the reason why we have scaled down in this budget what we are trying to do this year in general is because we could continue with our scope of work, but it would incur higher water rates. And I don't think that people are in the condition right now to be taking radically higher water rates in this economy. The reason why there is a shortfall is because there is a one member agency that does seem to have a difference of opinion as to how much they should be contributing. And therefore, it would be unwise of us to stop budgeting how much they owe the rest of the collective. And so it shows up as a budget shortfall. Am I correct with that?
Follow up on that one. Yet, we are expecting increases in our water rates in the city. So
everybody is on track to have certain water rate increases. The question is,
right,
if we increase the scope of work, we would incur higher increases, ones that are not in step with the moderate CPI that we have traditionally done.
Ms. Bjork, do you have any further comments on that?
No, I think Councilmember Williams handled it very nicely. Thank you.
Okay.
And I'll just add that the reason why we bring this so early is because in the past this has always been brought to the council after it has already been voted on CCRB, which doesn't really give you much of an option to change things. It just gives you the option to blow the whole thing up or ratify it. So I bring it here so that you actually can, if there is something that you wish to suggest either at this hearing or, you know, potentially if it's less than a quorum, less than a majority afterwards, then the suggestion can be made before I, on the city's part, vote on the CCRB budget.
Okay. Any other council comments on this? Mr. House.
Yes, to Ms. Bjork. The nature of this is all by cooperative agreement between the different parties.
Mayor Pro Tem, Councilmember House, the city is a member of a joint powers agreement along with the other South Coast purveyors. So, yes, we are a member of this agreement by our choice. It is, I believe we have an opportunity to discontinue participating with this group if we wanted to. The reason the Joint Powers Authority was created was that all of us have very similar interests and found we were doing duplicative work, and by joining together and doing the work jointly, we're able to do it more effectively and more cost effectively.
Mm-hmm. And the direction of my question is more to what remedies do the majority partners have with regards to a minority who is in dispute with the rest and has an effect on the budget?
And it's a little complicated in that the minority partner is actually not a part of the JPA. That partner is actually participating because some of the things that are done by this authority are conditions, mandatory conditions of the Kachuma project, and so we have an obligation as members of the Kachuma project to do those, and some of them are things that are being done because we were able to get grant funding, and they're good projects to help preserve our water rights and restore fish habitat, and those are discretionary, and the non-JPA member has withheld interest in participating in the discretionary portions, and because they're not a member of the JPA, they have asserted that right. There have been ongoing discussions about how to better manage the contractual agreements between the agencies. It's moving forward extremely slowly on that regard. The reflected deficit is there as somewhat as a placekeeper, and as with many budgets, there are opportunities to not spend some of the money, and so historically we haven't had to go back and find the money to cover that shortfall. However, if there was a shortfall that needed to be covered, I think that would be one of the things that would be discussed at CCRB and then either brought back for a supplemental appropriation from the different member agencies or bring some more pressure to bear perhaps on the other member agency to contribute.
I see. Okay. Well, peer pressure aside, it sounds like the actual budget for the Joint Powers authority is in balance, and this is reflecting the discretionary component of it. Am I correct in understanding that?
That's a good way to put it, yes.
Okay. Well, I think it's important that we actually called out, and I appreciate Mr. Horton for doing that and Mr. Williams for explaining it, because we have a mutual interest in what we don't. Perhaps it would be better, and this is something just as a suggestion since we have the opportunity to distinguish those interests in the report, because I think it takes a while to understand it, and it may be unnecessary to confuse the joint powers component with the discretionary component. That's it, and I really appreciate the early information. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Bjork. I don't believe a motion is required for this item. We're going to take a 5-minute break before the next item. City Council meeting of April 14th is now back in session. Okay, item 16.
Composting contract for business food scrap recovery program.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem, Council members. My name is Stephen McIntosh. I'm the Environmental Services Supervisor. What we have before you for your consideration today is a contract with Engel & Gray Composting Facility up in Santa Maria. This came about as a result of a pilot program that we launched back in April of 2007. We have 12 participants in that program.
Wait, Mr. Francisco, Mr. Mayor Pro Tem, we're only...
We have 12 participants in that program, including Harding and Peabody Elementary Schools, which are actually now zero-waste cafeterias. Cottage Hospital, Santa Barbara City College, the zoo, and a couple of restaurants and a couple of coffee shops. To date, almost 700,000 pounds of food scraps have been diverted from landfill disposal, representing approximately 260 Priuses taken off the road and greenhouse gas emissions. We've gathered a great deal of operational data that's going to help us with a full-scale program for the business sector. We have 70-plus businesses on our waiting list who have contacted us asking to be a part of this new program when it's launched and available to all businesses. Again, this program is reducing greenhouse gas emissions from landfill disposal. It's generating high-quality compost. It really is turning a community liability into an asset. We've identified approximately 400 restaurants and related food serving businesses with the potential to divert several thousand tons of food scraps per year. The preliminary agreement with the Engel & Gray folks and the city is $50 per ton for hauling and composting. That's actually taking it up to Santa Maria and then turning it into a valuable soil amendment. That represents a $19.50 per ton savings when you compare that to the landfill rate for next year beginning July 1 of $69.50 per ton. We are delaying this program by a couple of months so that we have more time to reach out to the business community. We were originally estimating a launch date of July 1, 2009, and when we brought the new proposed rate structure to council back in the beginning of March and received direction from you to approve in concept, and from some of the feedback we were receiving from the business community, we decided it was in our best interest and in the business community's interest to reach out for a few more months, make sure we can let as many businesses know about the new rate structure and the food scrap recovery program. And with that, I'd be happy to take any questions.
Okay, Mr. House.
Very good. I just wanted to thank you for your very cogent presentations when you explain this kind of stuff to the public. I've seen you in action, and I think it's just great, Mr. McIntosh. I also wanted to, without offering a question, I want to just make a comment. I've seen this in action, seeing it work, actually, in a place right near my store downtown, and it's been really wonderful. It's unbelievable how effective this composting food scraps program is in terms of cleaning up the areas around the bins and dumpsters near restaurants. It completely transforms the entire area that at one point had been a smelly refuse, kind of bad place with issues of rats and who knows what other vectors, and makes it into a clean place, a place that somebody could walk and not feel in danger, and just really, it's just remarkable. And setting, and not even mentioning all the other benefits of not putting all this into the landfill in the first place. And so I think your comment that this is turning a liability into an asset is something that we really can stand on, and will be something that you're going to have a lot of interest in participating in. And businesses that are associated or nearby restaurants, I think, will really welcome this. And I'm sure you've had comments to that effect so far.
Thank you.
Mr. Horton?
Yes. I sent out some questions Sunday on this, which unfortunately didn't get answered. But I want to follow up on what Mr. House said. Stephen made a presentation this morning to the Downtown Organization Board, and there was a lot of questions. And I think it was a really great presentation. I think the members, which are going to be your key participants in the downtown area, are really beginning to get the message on this. And they had some good questions, and I think that kind of activity is great, and we need to keep it up. My question really is probably a city attorney question, and he's not here. But I thought we had a ruling on no-bid contracts in the city, and from what I recall from the last time we had one of these, the amount of this contract is considerably over what would be permitted for a no-bid contract. So that probably isn't even in your area. And I don't have any problem with any of it, nor with the company or anything. But really, it's a question of why do we not have to get into issues of waiving the no-bid contract in this case. And I see we now have a city attorney, so maybe he can help me.
Mayor Pro Tem and Councilmember Horton, if I may, as a precursor to what the city attorney might say, we actually procured three written bids from composting facilities, one out in the Valley, McCarthy Family Farms, where our biosolids are currently sent, or the majority of the biosolids are sent, and then another at another facility down east of Los Angeles. Those prices came in competitively, but the distances were much further, and I think what we decided was, rather than put trucks on the road for several hundred miles at a similar cost, we use the facility we've been using that's much closer, and we have a relationship established currently, but the technical or the legal component of that I can't speak to.
Yeah, that's not my problem. What I want to know is, legally, is that okay? Because this staff report here does not cover what the wording we typically see for a no-bid contract. So maybe this isn't that, or maybe I just didn't read it right, but I didn't see anything in here about having a set of bids. Normally speaking, when we have contracts like this, we see the other bids listed, and then we pick the lowest bid or whatever. I just didn't see that in this case.
Okay. Mr. Armstrong?
While the city attorney is still trying to figure out, I believe that this would be considered professional services rather than, you know, when we buy widgets or supplies, then clearly you have to go to bid. But when we buy professional services, then there's leeway as long as there's a good basis on how we chose a company, just like with we engineering services and other types of services. But I think that's part of the answer.
Mr. Mayor, if I could, Bob Samario, Assistant Finance Director. This is one of those unusual kinds of contracts where it was sort of a combination of a blend between a professional service and the purchase of just some goods and services. And so we did do, as Mr. McIntosh indicated, we did solicit bids, and we did base the selection primarily on all factors, including price. The distance was a big factor, of course. But in the end, we treated this primarily as a professional service, and since it does exceed $25,000, we decided to come to council and get formal approval for the contract.
Okay. Mr. Wiley, do you have anything to add to this?
Well, Mr. Mayor, Councilmember Horton, clearly this is not a public works, and the charter only requires, or a public works contract, construction of a public improvement. we're not constructing anything here. That's when the charter clearly requires a public bidding process that results in the bid being awarded to the lowest responsible bidder. So I've heard the responses from the other city staff members. This is akin, I think, to a professional services contract. We did apparently solicit bids, and that's our typical purchasing process. That's a policy for this sort of thing that we follow. I think it's provided for in our purchasing ordinances. But there wasn't any absolute requirement that this be awarded to the lowest responsible bidder.
Thank you. I have a question for Mr. McIntosh, if no one else does. Mr. McIntosh, I'm glad to hear there was a meeting with the DO this morning. One of the concerns that was expressed to me by a couple of business owners after the earlier meeting was the whole question of locating extra bins. And what one of them told me was, well, early on in the program, when there aren't that many restaurants doing this, it may be feasible to find bin space. But as you ramp up the number of participants, it gets harder and harder. Is that something that has been discussed?
Mayor Pro Tem, the space constraint issue is at the top of our list or at the top of our toolkit, what we're talking to the businesses about out there with regards to increasing their recycling or introducing new food scraps. Will be all about getting creative and figuring out how to locate a new third container, a food scraps container, whether it be a 32-gallon cart or a 2-cubic-yard dumpster or bin. But what we've found and what we've researched and found from other jurisdictions is that while you're introducing another container type, the existing containers can actually be reduced in size. So if that can accommodate that business's needs, where a 3-yard dumpster actually can go down to a 1.5, and then we can squeeze in a couple of food scrap containers, or switch that entire arrangement where the 1.5 is now food scraps and the 295s become trash, like they did at the El Encanto Hotel. I think we can take care of situations like that with some creativity and some past practice actually from the last couple of years.
And what would you say, based on this morning's meeting, were the main concerns that businesses had, other than the space constraint?
Mayor Pro Tem, one of the concerns that didn't come up that we were happy about, and I think that we've addressed very well, is the public health issue. The fact that trash or garbage, food scraps, are in the trash containers currently, and I think the community is getting that material is there already. It's just going into another container now, and the containers are most likely going to be closed. So, like Councilmember House said, we think we're actually improving the situation, the health situation in most instances. One of the interesting concerns that came up this morning was the cost of the bags or biodegradable bags, because a lot of businesses are going to be using 32-gallon carts, and if that cart inside the restaurant is going to have a lot of wet garbage or wet food scrap going into every day, lining it with some sort of a bag will be important, so that they're not having to rinse it out and spray a bunch of water and get that into the storm drain or wherever it might go. So the cost of the bags currently is a little more than traditional bags. A medium-sized 40-gallon bag, I think, is 32 cents or something like that. That does eat into the savings that a business can realize. But there are more vendors coming on board all the time, and we're seeing the prices come down almost on a monthly basis. We're getting contacts from bag vendors all the time. But in anticipation of that question, or in response to it, I thought that might come up here today. So I had my staff look at a couple of examples out there, actual examples in the community. Here at a multi-unit complex, with food scraps and recycling services increased to 68%, they would save $5,500 a year in trash and recycling and food scraps services, but that would be offset, or they'd have to pay. Oh, it's still on. Approximately $500 in the cost for bags. So the $5,500 savings, $500 of that would be eaten away by the cost of the bags. Another really good example, and the larger it gets, the less of an issue that the more expensive bags are. But this is the last one I'll give you. But the last example is lazy acres, they would actually save, if they can get up to over 85% diversion, which we think they can because of their waste stream, they're going to be saving almost $25,000 a year. The cost of the bags for them are between $2,500 and $5,000. So they're still going to save a great deal of money.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. McIntosh. Mr. Schneider.
Thank you. I appreciate the answers to those questions and responding to the business community, because it's going to take their partnership to make this work. And the other thing comes to mind, we've received a lot of comments from various sectors about reducing single-use bags, both plastic and paper, and if we want to move in that direction and make it effective, this is the first step actually in getting there and creating a biodegradable way that doesn't go to the landfill and create methane gas, and this is a way to compost it and create something of value. So I'm very excited to see this move forward, but want to continue encouraging you to work with the business community and get that buy-in, because I think that's key. So with that, I'll move the staff recommendation.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. Item 17.
Airport Terminal Project, City Financing of Joint Use Rental Car Facility.
Mr. Pearson.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor Pro Tem, members of Council, Bob Pearson, Finance Director. And we have before you today an item that was actually on the Finance Committee agenda earlier today. So for the half of you that sat through this once before, you have my sympathy. But it is an important subject. As you know, we have been before the Finance Committee and the City Council a number of times on the airport terminal project. And the item that we have for you today, I think, is an excellent way that we have identified to develop sort of, I hate the cliche, but a win-win situation for both the airport and the city. As you know, I think you'll recall that a component of the terminal project was what is called the Joint Use Rental Car Facility. It is a portion of the project that needed to be started before the main terminal project began, because the existing airport rental car facility just to the south of the terminal had to be demolished in order to allow the site preparation work on the main terminal project to begin. And so we came to the City Council last July and told the council at that time that this component of the project needed to proceed despite the fact that we had not yet secured financing for the overall project. And so at that time we recommended, and the council authorized, the airport to issue a $7.8 million promissory note, which would the proceeds of which would fund the construction of this new joint use rental car facility. And the council authorized the issuance of that $7.8 million promissory note and authorized me, the finance director, to buy that promissory note into the city's investment portfolio. That, at the time, we expected that the promissory note would be paid off from the proceeds of the terminal bond issue, which will finance the entire project. And at the time, we thought that that would happen sometime in the fall of 2008. As the fall was moving along, we realized that due to the bond market constraints, we would not be getting to the market in 2008. And so we came back to the City Council in December and asked for authorization to extend the maturity of this airport promissory note to June 30th of this year. And Council granted that permission. The $7.8 million promissory note helped fund the project, which is now, I'm guessing, 50 to 60% complete. And on a side note, it does look like we will, as I told the Finance Committee, finally be going to the bond market about 2 weeks from now to sell the bonds for the terminal project. But as we were finalizing the structure of the bond deal for the terminal project, in talking with our financial advisor and our underwriter, Morgan Stanley, it became apparent that the rental car facility component of the financing was going to be problematic. And to refresh your memory, the way the bond deal was originally envisioned was that there would be two components to it. One would be a tax-exempt component for the main terminal project, because it's a public facility. And this rental car facility financing would be a second component as a taxable bond deal, because it is used for private sector for-profit businesses. And under the tax code, that means it has to be a taxable bond piece. So the original bond structure for the project envisioned a big piece for the terminal public facility and a smaller taxable piece for the rental car facility. As we are approaching marketing the bonds, it became apparent, based on feedback from our financing team, that the much smaller taxable piece for this joint-use rental car facility could complicate the marketing of our main bond issue, because although the bond market for tax-exempt municipal bonds has recovered nicely in the last 3 or 4 months, the market apparently does not yet have much of an appetite for taxable municipal debt. And so the bond, our bond team was telling us that as of last week, the taxable piece, if we were to sell that on Wall Street, would probably command an interest rate of some 8.5%. We were actually looking at it. What they said really was that it would be 5% above the 30-year Treasury rate. And we were looking at that today, and it actually probably makes it more like 8.6 or 8.65% today. And so with the bond team telling us that, A, we'd have an interest rate on this component of 8.5 or more, and that it could complicate the marketing of the entire bond issue, the bulk of which is for the tax-exempt piece for the airline terminal project, it did occur to us that since we had provided city financing for this component of the project for about 11 months now, that it might be in our interest to consider city financing long-term for this component of the project, and therefore be able to remove it from the bond deal that we'll go to market with in a couple weeks. And really, that has three advantages in staff's opinion. One is, as I mentioned, it will facilitate the bond sale of the main terminal project bond, which, you know, we're talking $40 million compared to $7.5 million. It would offer us the chance to, if we were to provide city financing, earn a rate of return which is as much as 3 times or more the rate of return we're currently earning on newly purchased investments like treasuries and federal agency securities. And it would also offer the opportunity to save the airport a considerable amount of money off the 8.5% rate that we were being told the market would command. And so really, that's what led us to consider recommending to the council long-term financing, city financing for this piece. And as I said, it was originally a $7.8 million promissory note. That's what's outstanding now. It's set, scheduled to mature on or before June 30th of this year. So that's what we're recommending to the council today, is that we consider recommending to you that we finance long term on a 20-year basis. The financing for this joint use rental car facility, the structure of the deal would be a $7.3 million promissory note to be issued by the airport, and I will talk about that. That's about $500,000 less than the short term note that is currently outstanding. It would be a 20-year term. Staff had recommended to the Finance Committee this afternoon an interest rate of 6.5%. I will tell you that the Finance Committee unanimously voted this afternoon to recommend to Council that the rate be increased to 7%, which is slightly closer to the market rate, while still providing substantial savings to the airport. And the amortization schedule based on a 6.5% rate was included in the agenda report. One of the things I need to mention is that under the state public investing code and under the city's investment policy, this is considered a permitted investment is the term. Section 53601E of the Public Investing Code, State Public Investing Code, authorizes us to purchase bonds, notes, warrants, or other evidence of indebtedness of any local agency within the state, including payable solely out of the revenues from revenue-producing property owned, controlled, or operated by the local agency or by a department, board, or agency or authority of the local agency. And that's essentially what we are recommending. We are recommending that you authorize the airport to issue a $7.3 million promissory note. We are recommending that you authorize me as the finance director to then purchase that promissory note into the city's investment portfolio. The other piece of the public investing code I want to mention is that under both our investment policy and the public investing code, we are limited to purchasing investments with a final maturity of no more than 5 years from the date we acquire the investment. Now, we're recommending that a 20-year term on this, but the Public Investing Code authorizes the governing body to authorize staff to purchase investments that exceed the 5-year maximum, as long as that authorization is received by the from the governing body at least 3 months prior to the purchase of the investment. And so what we're recommending to you today is that you extend the existing short-term note, authorize the extension of that maturity from June 30th to July 13th, and that you authorize the issuance of the new 20-year promissory note as of July 14th, which is 3 months from today. And then that you authorize me as the finance director to purchase that 20-year term note into the portfolio. I want to stress that this is not an interfund loan. This is not use of general fund proceeds. This is not use of any particular funds or reserves from any of the city's operating funds. This is simply to be purchasing an investment just like we would purchase treasury bills or federal agency securities as part of our investment portfolio. And so it's not an interfund loan. It's simply the purchase of an investment. As I mentioned to you, the interest rate at 7% as recommended by the Finance Committee is more than three times the current market rate. Obviously, that will generate a substantial amount of interest, which will then be allocated across all of the funds based on their cash balances in our investment portfolio. The general fund will, of course, capture a portion of that increased investment earnings, and in this budget environment, that is always welcome. What else do I need to say? Yes, thank you, Jim. The interest rate at 7%, the way the note would be drafted based on what we're recommending is that the interest rate would be set at 7% or the LAIF rate, whichever is higher, with a cap of 9%. And what that means is, obviously, if interest rates over the course of the next 10 or 15 or 20 years go up substantially, then the note would pay the rate, whichever's higher, the 7% or LAIF rate up to 9%. Now, I will say that right now, LAIF is at like 1.7, so there's a long way to go, but it does provide some measure of earnings protection to the portfolio if, when the economy turns around, inflation takes off and interest rates follow, we would at least have some protection up to 9%. So that's what we're recommending, and it concludes my report.
Thank you, Mr. Pearson. Questions from the council? Mr. House.
So in terms of paying this back, who's actually paying? I mean, I'd say paying back like it's a loan, but as it gets recovered, where do the funds come from? I want to really be sure I understand that.
Yeah, and that's an important piece, and I obviously should have mentioned that. Thank you for the question. This is a joint-use rental car facility, and we had imposed a customer facility charge, CFC. It's a $10 charge per rental car contract for all rental car contracts at the airport. This CFC is authorized under state law, and we have imposed it since January of 2006. And really, the only use for those funds is to pay for this facility. It's a restricted revenue source that can only be used to pay for this facility or to pay the debt service that was used to construct this facility. So we do have a dedicated source of repayment for this note, which is not general airport revenue. It's a restricted customer facility charge on the rental car facility. And we currently have by the end of the fiscal year, we're expecting that we'll have about $1.2 million in the bank from accumulated CFCs. Some of the money that we've collected to date was used for the design of the project, but there will be, by the end of the fiscal year, about $1.2 million left in cash in CFC receipts in the fund. We're recommending that $500,000 of that be used to lower the note amount from the $7.8 million temporary note, short-term note, to the $7.3 million long-term note. The question was asked at Finance Committee, well, why only $500,000? And the answer to that is that another $500,000 will be used to pay the interest for this fiscal year on the short-term note. That interest will be due on June 30th. It will be about $504,000. So we have to leave enough to pay that. And then that'll still leave $200,000 to $300,000 left in CFC revenues in the fund. And staff recommends that that amount be left in the fund as a cushion in case future receipts run a little short. We will have a cushion with which to supplement the income to make sure the debt service payments can be made.
And this is structured in such a way that the anticipated income from the rental car facility, that CFC charge, will be sufficient to cover the payments?
Actually, the answer to that for the most part is yes. I will say, and I need to say, that for the first couple years, we're actually projecting an 8% drop in the CFC revenues this fiscal year from last because of the decline in the passenger counts. And then next year, we're projecting no growth, zero. So for the first 2 years, the debt service at 7% would be about $30,000 or $40,000 more than the projection for the CFC revenue. But we do, as I said, we will have $200,000 to $300,000 of accumulated CFC revenues in the bank to cushion that. Mm-hmm. And then the projection is, starting in about 3 years, that it would grow at about 2% a year, the CFC revenue, which would quickly provide sufficient funds to cover the level debt service. And in fact, if the growth rate continues at 2% in the out years, the airport will be able to accelerate payment on the debt.
Are those paid on a monthly basis or an annual basis?
We've actually structured it rather on a semi-annual basis, principal and interest every 6 months.
Okay. All right, very good. So I think as much for me maybe as for the but for the public, this is something that will not take away from the funds that are needed to run the airport. It's within the enterprise fund, but even better than that, it's actually directly associated revenue and cost and the repayment with the facility that it's actually intended to serve.
That's correct, and we've actually set up a separate fund within the airport department to account for the CFC revenues.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Mr. Horton?
I think Mr. Pearson has explained this well. My thinking in suggesting that we increase the percentage a little bit was because the advisor to the airport said that 8.5% would be a market rate. So it seemed to me that bumping it up to 7 just generates a little bit more money for us in a time when we need a little bit more money. And every time I see something like that as chairman of finance, that's what I intend to do. So having said that, I'm going to move staff recommendations A, B, and C.
Second that.
Second, but with the 7% instead of 6.5, because the staff recommendation says 6.5. I'm sure that's what you meant.
I meant the new staff recommendation.
Okay.
Very good. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Item 18, the closed session item.
Conference with legal counsel regarding pending litigation.
Okay, and we will adjourn out of that closed session. Thank you.
Good job, Mayor Pro Tem.
Yeah.
First time.
Not bad for first flight.